Thank you, Rob. And thanks to the folks that were in our breakout room. This issue of workforce has been one of New Mexico's largest conversations for a really long time. And as you see from the report, there's a lot that we can do. There's a lot that we should do. But for 45 minutes, our conversation focused around a couple of areas. Number one, the conversation focused on equipping the people who are here to be the talent that we need. So the majority of the people in the room wanted to talk about improving the number of workers with work readiness skills and in-demand middle skills. And we talked about that from a lot of perspectives. The ACT community National Career Readiness Certificate is what is advanced in the report. And I think that our group likes the idea of having, you know, quantifiable skills in the talent and quantifiable skills that the employers can choose from. They weren't necessarily sold on the ACT model, but the idea of aligning individuals with opportunity on a skills basis was really championed. Raising the awareness and the expectations of our students about what they're capable of was a lot of the conversation as well. Helping our students to see, you know, that they are the talent that we need, that they can have the skills that we need was really a lot of the conversation as well. The value of, you know, what we used to call vocational education that we now call career and technical education, and really supporting the idea that all students could be CTE students because of the career readiness application to it, the hands-on, you know, career connection of it really being important. And you know, as one of our participants talked about, you know, they didn't have any dropouts with when students' education was connected to its application and career. And that's actually very true of CTE in our state already. So how do we broaden exposure to that? Also, the conversation was around equipping sort of the people who sit across the desk from a student and thinking about their future, you know, helping that person have more ability to hear the student, to work with parents who know their students, to help that student envision their future. And as it relates to STEM, you know, showing them that STEM can be something they love, not necessarily pushing them into that, but aligning things that the student already loves to the STEM careers. You know, if we were going to pursue something like that grant to grant for tuition to support that, making sure that it's not that we're driving the student to but really more, I think, about leading the student to that. We had, you know, the STEM Boomerang creator on the call, and really, you know, that practical experience led to a lot of the conversation that we were having. The other thing is just about awareness. Building awareness. These students don't know the incredible careers that are here. How do we do more awareness building, which I think gets to the other recommendation about the Be Pro Proud, about building awareness and perceptions of these technical careers, mm-hmm. and frankly what they can pay. But we really need to think about that. The other piece of the conversation that we might have wanted to talk about but we didn't have time was about expanding the opportunities for underserved populations and communities. That was something that we wanted to talk about, but we didn't have the time. So thank you for that, Rob.
Great, thank you, Tracy. Next, I'd like to ask Richard Enklum, president of New Mexico Tax Research Institute, to talk about the discussion regarding regulatory business climate.
Sure, thank you, Rob. We were tasked with discussing how to make New Mexico regulatory environment among the most business friendly in the state. Some of the recommendations we were talking about was creating an office of regulatory reform, a governor's office, implementing requirements that agencies do comprehensive reviews and things of that nature. We cited, you know, the Arizona experience where they've seemed to have some success in removing some burdensome regulations and reducing some costs. Virginia had a program where they had to reduce the number of burdensome regulations by 25%. There was plenty of frustration regarding the regulatory environment in New Mexico, for sure. A lot of that's industry dependent. I think construction has as much angst as anybody, but certainly other industries as well. Silos, inability to even get a straight answer as to where to go, lack of responsibility, no coordination amongst, you know, state agencies, much less local and tribal, all kind of resonated, I think, in the conversation. So I think there was certainly plenty of support for that. There was a concern about some blanket statewide number in terms of just repealing so many burdensome regulations if there wasn't some kind of support for that number, if it seemed a little arbitrary to one or two of the commenters. But otherwise, the notion of focusing on regulations was certainly a good one. Another question or strategy was to conduct a review of the state taxes that stand out as anti-competitive, such as labor and equipment tax, which is really our gross receipts tax, in general. And the other example was our weight distance tax. We're one of just a couple of states that impose that tax, which can have some logistical issues for the transportation industry. When you mention the gross receipts tax, you get emotional reactions. So it became difficult to build a consensus just because there were experiences with the taxes that weigh on folks. But I don't think there was any opposition at all to continuing the conversation and trying to get something done with respect to eliminating these burdensome taxes. Regarding an annual business survey, we ran out of time, didn't really get any real good discussion on that question. So that was what we covered.
Thank you, Richard. I appreciate that. Next, we'll move over to Mathis Shinnick, CEO of Off the Pulse Inc., and to talk a little bit about infrastructure.
Sure. We had three topics that we went through. One, rural grant fund programs. Second one being public-private partnerships, PPPs, and the third one being rail spur economic development. Coming back to what seems to be a theme, which you heard both Richard and Tracy, is that the rural economic development aspect and having funds for that is something that was absolutely necessary in people's minds, but not necessarily just to have it, not such that it is a prize for a legislator to take back to community and say, here, I got some funds, but to have it tied to the workforce development aspects that are now part of this next new normal. One of the key comments that came out in the group was the need for broadband across all of our rural communities. Bringing 4G where it isn't, even expanding to 5G, should we be able to get that far? And through that, bringing on opportunities in education and jobs and wellness, engineering could be done from there, 3D printing could be done, logistics management, coders, et cetera. So that was all part of the conversation around investing in this infrastructure, this broadband infrastructure. The attitude, interesting enough, was that we are turning the corner, that we have to believe that this is the attitude, that no longer can we afford to have a scarcity mentality, that we need to look at the opportunity that we have within the state, which flies well with the report that was done by the New Mexico Chamber. And in that, taking on these projects, being on the offense, was one of the terms used by the people in the group, looking at picking on the initiative versus trying to protect what you have already. So on the PPP side, the key comment that came out of that public-private partnership is that we need enabling legislative action in order to have PPPs here in the state. That we are behind other states and that action needs to be taken in order to get to the point where we've got a pathway that people could then follow, and that each idea or project that's a PPP that gets proposed isn't tackled as a one-off at the legislature. And then on the rail spur, essentially is economic development around existing infrastructure. That got broadened out to logistics overall and looking at the economic development around logistics. So not just roads and rails, but also broadband in terms of that being an infrastructure item. And then looking at warehousing, looking at the airport, look at the spaceport as well, and how logistics activities around infrastructure creates clusters around which you then build advanced manufacturing and play to the strengths of the state. So those were the aspects. And Bob, I look forward to coming back to you and talking more about the whole logistics side of that versus just the rail spur. Thank you.
Mathis, thank you for that. That's a great report out. And it, you know, it's interesting that with the logistics conversation that ties in with Richard's comments regarding the different tax that we have on trucking that others do not have. So I think there's a variety of these little pieces that if we start to chip away at, we can, you know, really start to move the ball down the field. Next, I will move over to Juanita Tuttle. She's the manager of Tramway Venture Partners. Talk about kind of the rapid change around emerging opportunities and entrepreneurship.
Thank you very much. We had a spirited group, certainly a lot of entrepreneurial energy there. And, you know, we focused on the barriers and the gap between technology transfer as a process of licensing, et cetera, and true commercialization outcomes. And, you know, as I've thought back on all the comments and tried to crystallize, I think one area that kind of permeated it all was the need to have a culture of risk tolerance. And it kind of, I'm harkening back to what Mathis just said in terms of being on offense. And this idea of risk tolerance relates to a couple of subtopics. We always talk about the need for capital. We need capital in rural areas, urban areas. We need capital across the spectrum of stages of development of companies. But really that capital, to the extent it is focused through the state by public entities, has a very risk adverse underpinning to it. And that idea of knowing that some resources are going to be spent that will fail, that's the definition of taking risk and being on offense and growing. So I think that relates to our approach to capital formation, and the state is understanding risk tolerance and having a positive idea that we can do everything to mitigate risk, but that it will come. I think it also relates to the whole idea of recruiting and developing senior management talent in the state. These kinds of folks gravitate to environments where risk is a culturally okay thing to do. So I think that was an important theme. We had a lot of discussion about specific topics and technologies and the ascendance of the opportunities in the space technology arena. Some people very excited about really taking some initiative around the recruitment of management talent, all positive things. One set of negative comments was around the difficulties presented by the state government in terms of partly regulatory, partly procurement processes, et cetera, in really letting companies grow in New Mexico. And it was interesting, this was particularly from one commentator who said it's not political, it's not at the leadership levels, it's at the day-to-day working level. So that I'll put on the table as a negative, but generally a very positive and a real focus on developing a culture of risk tolerance and understanding what that means. A lot of discussion about how the expectation that all the scientists working at the lab are going to become entrepreneurs who leave and start businesses is not realistic, that it has to be a partnership that comes, that draws that out. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Juanita. And finally, we'll go to John Clark, who's our Deputy Cabinet Secretary for the Mexico Economic Development Department, to talk about amplifying the voice of business.
Great, thank you, Rob. We had a great discussion in our breakout room, and I think a couple of things quickly emerged. One was that there was a lot of feedback that there is too much of an economic development perspective on economic development planning and efforts instead of a business perspective, and that we need to try to take off our economic development hats and put on our business hats when we're interacting with businesses, when we're asking them for feedback, and when we're setting up metrics to guide our success of what really matters to businesses and how should we be judging ourselves based on how well they're doing, as well as then, and this goes back to what Dr. Crow was talking about earlier, how do then we also judge our success by the secondary effects in the business community and the community as a whole? The other thing that came out early on was that There are just too many layers between economic developers and businesses to be able to address some of the issues that come up with business in New Mexico. One of the things that was mentioned was that a lot of our startup businesses and small businesses in general just don't have the time to even take one day out of their lives each year to come to an annual event where we try to pair the private sector and public sector organizations to get feedback. So in addition to doing things like that, we need to reach out to partner organizations, organizations like the Manufacturing Extension Partnership, but also have a series of one-on-one meetings with businesses, representative selection of businesses, to try to get their feedback on what really needs to change in New Mexico, what's in it for them, rather than just sort of generic economic development planning. Another thing that came up a number of times in the conversation was that there's too much negativity regarding doing business in New Mexico and economic development in New Mexico, and that we need to do a better job of highlighting our successes, highlighting business wins in the state, and talking about how the businesses did that. Creating success stories as well as information on how the business got there. How did they do that? And then connecting other businesses with those same opportunities, those same connections, tools, so that other companies can follow suit. But also just in general, making our economic development efforts and our business climate more open and welcoming of businesses. There's just too much negativity is what we heard a number of times. But I think one of the things that really was particularly helpful for me, since we're going to be working on strategic planning efforts, was the notion that we really need to take a step back and not look at standard economic development metrics, but think about what matters in the end to businesses. How can we try to measure that? Because if our businesses are doing well, the jobs and investment will continue to come.
Thank you, John. And I guess that gets to Mr. Crow or Dr. Crow's comment as well, is how do we measure success from the university in the Department of Education? It's the success of the educated, the K through 12. And so it is an interesting way to kind of rethink how we think about those measurements and what we're doing there. Next, I'd like to ask Ted, to give a little perspective kind of after the report out. He joined us in the breakout room as well, and I know he was in some of the other conversations, just for some thoughts on as it relates to broader competitiveness.
Yeah, thanks, Rob. So I'm heartened all day long listening to people talk about what can be done. I think that's the purpose of the plan. I think we all struggle at times like this because plans try to balance the broad with the specific. And Rob, as you know, through the whole process, we struggled with every conversation of do we want to be broader and strategic? Do we want to be episodic and specific? And we tried to create a balance on that. So I thought that was reflected in what you heard today. I think that overall, the message when we looked at the competitiveness was very simple. It was, how do you have more workers with the right skills? And so some of that is attraction, and some of that is helping parents and students understand what the opportunities are in New Mexico and will be, and getting them trained. Some of that is retraining. We haven't said that all day today, but the life cycle of skills is shorter and shorter. And so the ability to retrain a 30-year-old and a 40-year-old and a 50-year-old to the new skills is part of a system that works. And I think that, so overall that challenge is, how do we fuel growth with enough people? And then secondarily, how do we compete against other states as a place with better regulatory environment or perceived regulatory environment? And I think that we heard a couple times, I've been watching through the chats today, what specifically, and I think it's worth having a real discussion about specific regulations. And the report didn't recommend a specific number. It said, review your regs and try to get better. And I think that is a broad-based thing and something that needs to be done. The tax stuff, and I saw this with a couple legislators this morning, generally, you're competitive in taxation. You just have a few outstanding things that hurts you specifically. And so looking at those outstanding things, and there may be really good reasons for having them, but if there aren't, they do hurt you, and they hurt you in very specific segments. And then, trying to figure out whether the legal and regulatory perceptions are there. I think John's right on economic development overall. Economic development is about growing the overall economy, and business grows that. And let's look at metrics that are different. I'm a big fan of numbers, as you know, and having a dashboard that allows you to view some of those things are important, but they ought to be different. And I think what you heard overall today was a lot of different people with a lot of ideas of how to make things better. And if you can align those, if you can use an impact model where you align what different groups are trying to do, then for goodness sakes, everybody working as hard as they can on different things is absolutely the way to move a state faster. I think the other thing that you heard today that I didn't talk about much this morning was, did the world change on us over the last 12 months, and what's that going to be? And one of the things that I took away from the mayor's comments were, you can't be as broad as, you know, everything you want. You have to try to be narrower on things that you have opportunity in. I happen to think clusters are going to get more important in the next few years, because I think that people are going to dig a little deeper in the places where they have a competitive advantage. And so I think that trying to narrow down and be really strong in very specific areas, in terms of your worker training, your regulatory environment for those areas, your outreach, and all the rules and regs to try to help certain industries, whether that's alternative energy, whether it's space, whether it's outdoor recreation, whether it's film, whatever it is that you decide, and you'll go through that with your next plan at the state level. Whatever it is, try to be as competitive as possible, because the data that people get to judge you, everybody knows that when a company is considering a expansion, if they're a current New Mexico company, or if they're considering a relocation, they're going to look at data and try to figure out if they can be successful. So all of those comments are there, but overall, the energy around wanting to find ways to improve the standard of living and quality of life for every New Mexican is the real key. And there's lots of ways to do that. So I think you get some of them with a plan now. You get more with an economic development strategy and with aligning everybody else's. But it is all about, can you collaborate and implement things? Knowing to do something. Someone said this morning, I think, in the chat that, we've heard this before. And of course you have, because workforce and infrastructure and business climate have always been the determining factor of competitiveness for, my whole life. And I'm one of the older people on the call. So yes, we've heard it before, but it never goes away. Competitiveness is always a journey, because you're competing with other people who are trying to get better also, other states.
Thank you, Ted. I mean, I think from my comments, Lisa, would be, I think from the chamber's perspective, this was an amazing conversation, an amazing day. So again, thank you to UNM for the leadership to help bring this together. And I think what it speaks to is the need for these sort of ongoing processes. And that's what my hope is that the breakout groups, the ongoing conversations are part of something that we're going to be doing, not just today and tomorrow, but for years to come. We view this strategy document as a living document. It's something that will be evolving over time. We will need to be continuing to look at and to look back to our business community for feedback, to look at a continued competitive analysis. How are we doing along these different fronts in these areas of infrastructure, on workforce, on entrepreneurship? What are we doing to continue to move that? So from a chamber's perspective, we're going to be developing a dashboard that allows us to continue to track those things year over year. And what are the issues to move the needle in those various sectors? And my hope is that this group that we're working with today continues to be very engaged in shaping those discussions and helping us move those areas of competitiveness. Again, John is leading the effort at the state level around the broader economic strategy. And I think, again, continuing to collaborate within that model, but looking at how are we going to be competitive so that his job in recruiting and retaining businesses here is easier. And I think we had some great conversations that around some of those specific strategies today that can be very helpful. So with that, Lisa, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you, Rob, and thank you to our moderators and scribes who helped us with this last session. And thank you, Ted, for your insights, both this morning and this afternoon. I think that I just want to remind everyone that, you know, as it's been said before, we want this to be a continuing conversation. In that regard, we'll send out recordings of the event segmented by the various sections. You'll also get a summary report. We will capture the chat. Keep an eye on the website, innovations.unm.edu/summit, which is where we'll link, but we'll send you emails so you have that connection as things are put up there. I think that continuing our work, especially working with our state leaders, is really important in this next phase.